Hey guys, welcome back. This is your lesson for Friday, April 24th, as we continue our conversation about the executive branch. So as I mentioned last time, all of these executive powers, all of the conversation and everything having to do with the executive branch of the Constitution largely exists in Article 2. So just as a reference, the first thing we need to talk about when we talk about executive power and kind of the way that the White House operates are executive orders. Okay, so executive orders are regulations originating with the executive branch. They carry the full weight of law, but instead of being authorized or constructed by Congress, they originate and are constructed by and signed into law by the President of the United States. It's one of a few methods that the president can use to control the bureaucracy and to kind of push his agenda, his legislative agenda, without directly leaning on or working with the legislative branch to do so. Executive orders have been used in a wide variety of ways throughout American history. President Truman signed an executive order to desegregate the United States military. The Emancipation Proclamation from President Lincoln was an executive order. The desegregation of Southern schools, particularly having to do with and involving situations like that of the Little Rock Nine, that was an executive order. So they've been used in a wide variety of ways. They've been used in extremely high-profile situations as well. The interesting piece about executive orders is it really always kind of becomes a situation where the party that is not in the White House. So currently that would be Democrats. For President Obama, I'm talking about Republicans. They always tend to be very, very, very critical of the way that the president uses executive orders, and they say that he overuses them and that he's trying to take the place of the legislative branch. It was a criticism that for 8 years Republicans lobbed at President Obama, saying that he used executive orders way too frequently, was trying to go around Congress and not use them the way they're supposed to be used, but rather he was kind of trying to be the executive branch and the legislative branch all at once. The truth of that situation maybe isn't quite as egregious as Republicans at the time would have led us to believe. Because while you look at somebody like Reagan, who signed 381 executive orders in 8 years, and you look at George W. Bush, who signed 291 executive orders in 8 years, President Obama signed 182 executive orders in 8 years, right? So, it might have been politically, it might have been fun to take shots at President Obama and say that he was overutilizing executive orders, but he used them fewer than Reagan and he used them less frequently than Reagan and Bush. And we'll wait to see what happens with President Trump before we throw him into this mix and kind of see where he stacks up. But it's just a thing where when presidents use executive orders, the other party usually gets pretty fired up about it. They start saying stuff about it. They start questioning the president and whether or not he understands that the legislative branch's job is to make laws. It's just the way it goes, right? I mean, if you look back and you say, okay, how many executive orders did each of these people sign? Well, Barack Obama signed 33.6 executive orders per year. The last time somebody used executive orders that infrequently was Grover Cleveland. So wasn't necessarily a fair criticism, but it's been pretty standard on either side. Democrats are currently doing the same thing with President Trump. So it definitely happens both ways. Inside Article 2 of the Constitution, one of the pieces that's talked about with the executive branch is that he shall take care that the laws be faithfully executed. And one of the things that's included in that particular piece of Article 2 are the president's powers to issue pardons, the president's powers to give clemency. Clemency meaning to essentially reduce the sentence of somebody that's been punished, somebody that's been sent to jail or fined or whatever. When we talked about clemency, we talked about governors typically being the ones that use clemency, because governors do not have the constitutional authority to use a pardon. They have the constitutional authority, or they have the authority to use clemency, not pardons. Presidents, however, do have the opportunity to issue a pardon. They have the constitutional power to issue a pardon, which is, as you see here, the excusing of an offense without an exacting penalty. So you're basically saying, listen, I know you were found guilty of the crime. I know that you were sentenced and supposed to spend the next 25 years in jail, but I'm issuing a presidential pardon, which basically releases you from from the penalty or the consequence of that crime. And then the last piece, commutation, a substitution of one form of payment or charge for another. So in the case of presidents using commutations, basically that would be the executive branch saying, listen, instead of spending 20 years in prison, you're going to pay $100,000 fine instead. Or instead of a death sentence, you're going to get a life sentence with no chance for parole. It's just changing a sentence or changing a consequence. But clemency, particularly when it comes to pardons, that's typically the number we focused on most frequently. If you look at every president that has finished their time in office dating back to the start of the 1900s, you can see which presidents were very, very proactive in using their constitutional authority to issue pardons. And you can also see which presidents were more apt to use commutations. Commutations was the preference of President Obama. He was a pretty big outlier in that respect, in that, you know, of the 1900 clemency cases that are clemency situations he was involved in, 1700 of them were commutations. By contrast, almost 190 of 200, so 189 out of 200 comes out to like 95% of George W. Bush's clemency cases were pardons, and quite the opposite for President Obama. He was much more likely to use commutations than pardons, and he was extremely active with using his presidential or his executive power to issue pardons and commutations. He was very, very active in that regard. Probably the most famous presidential pardon in American history is that of Gerald Ford. Gerald Ford issued a presidential pardon to Richard Nixon, basically absolving him or removing any possible punishment and basically excusing him for the crimes surrounding the Watergate incident, the Watergate scandal. But probably the most infamous pardon in American history. The most traditional presidential pardon takes place every November when the president issues a pardon to a turkey right before Thanksgiving. So typically what happens is that the White House brings in two turkeys, and then the president ultimately says, okay, somebody in the president's staff decides which turkey is going to sit still for the picture, and then they bring that turkey outside somewhere, they take a picture, the president issues his pardon for a turkey, and it's kind of just in line with this Thanksgiving tradition of healing wounds and coming together, and it's hokey as all get out and cheesy as can be, but it's been going on since Abraham Lincoln, so we keep doing it every year. The president has a government that is absolutely massive, and it's insane to think that he's able to do this all by himself. He gets a ton of help from a bunch of different people in trying to manage all of these different pieces. The person that first comes to mind is the vice president. Well, John Nance Garner famously said that the vice president, it's not worth a pitcher of warm spit. For a long time, the vice presidency was, and to some degree still is, a very symbolic and not all that meaningful role. But there are some ways and some fashions where the vice president is absolutely a part of operating the government, helping the president run the government, and helping the president run the country. The interesting piece about vice presidents is that for whatever reason, every 4 years, every election cycle, we get all fired up about who's going to be the vice presidential choice. Is it going to be this person from a southern state? Is it going to be this person from a Midwestern state? Is it going to be a woman from California? Is it going to be? And frankly, I mean, we have those conversations and they show up on the news, but really it doesn't matter. Less than 5% of voters say that the vice presidential choice or the vice presidential candidate influences their vote. It's just not that important to people when they show up on election day, and it really is telling of the ultimate role of the vice president in the government. Really, all that can be said for vice presidents when it comes to elections is they hope to be able to provide some level of home state advantage, or they counter or balance out whatever the presidential candidate's perceived weakness might be. So when you look at Joe Biden in 2012,2008 and 2012, sorry, I was thinking 2008, but either way, In 2008, particularly, Joe Biden comes on and he's the experienced hand, right? He's the experience to President Obama's youth, and that's really the connection between the two. When you look at Paul Ryan, is really a stand-in or a figurehead of modern Republican politics in 2012. He's everything that's young and fresh and exciting about Republican politics at the time, or that's kind of the perception of him. And in running against Mitt Romney, Mitt Romney is a little bit more traditional. He's a little bit older. He's been around for a little bit, and he really isn't what you would consider an exciting conservative in 2012 in the same way that Paul Ryan is. So Paul Ryan gets added to the ticket because he is that young, exciting Republican. So that it's an opportunity for presidents or for presidential candidates to balance out their ticket a little bit. The same would have been true in 2016. If you look at Mike Pence, Mike Pence is a really, really traditional Midwestern Republican. He's served as an executive before. He was the governor of Indiana, right? So when you think about how he fits on a ticket with Donald Trump, a person that has zero experience serving in federal government, it makes sense to add somebody on the ticket, add somebody on his side that has experience running a government. Mike Pence fits the bill. When you talk about Donald Trump, he's never really been all that interested in talking about religion or making religion a part of his political persona. Mike Pence has been the exact opposite of that. He's been a very, very loud and devout Christian for a long time. So they balance each other out very, very well. Similarly, Tim Kaine does a lot of the same things for Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton's a woman. She's from the Northeast. Tim Kaine is he's obviously a man, but he's also from the South. He's from Virginia, right? So it's an opportunity for candidates to balance out their ticket or kind of address some of their weaknesses or their perceived weaknesses by the people that they select to be their vice presidential nominee. The Constitution, as far as what it says about the vice president's job, doesn't say a lot other than basically just kind of making the statement that you're always one heartbeat away from being in the big chair, right? You are one heartbeat away from being the guy running the show. Other than that, it does not address a lot of the vice president's job duties. Some vice presidents and president get along extremely well with their president, the president they work for. Joe Biden and Barack Obama probably being a really, really good and modern example of a president and vice president that had an outstanding relationship, continue to apparently, and worked very, very well together. Others absolutely do not. John Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson could not stand each other. They were paired up because Kennedy's from Massachusetts. He's from the Northeast and he's young. Lyndon Johnson's from Texas. So he's from the South and he's experienced. He has experience in federal government. They couldn't stand each other, but ultimately Democrats in 1960 made the decision that, hey, we need somebody to balance Kennedy out a little bit. Lyndon Johnson's the pick. I don't care. We don't care if you like him or not. He's going to be the guy. Ultimately, it does get Kennedy elected, but they never really were all that close. The vice president's job duties are all too frequently informal, right? They're the person that has to attend state weddings abroad. You know, if all of a sudden some member of the British royal family gets married, the president can't go to all of those international weddings. He might send the vice president. If there's a state funeral, a world leader dies somewhere across the world, the vice president represents the United States at a state funeral, things like that. And then they're really going to be a significant piece of a campaign process, particularly as a fundraiser. They're obviously not the person doing the big televised speeches. They're not the one doing the 45-minute on-air debates several times, but they're going to be really critical behind the scenes, right? So again, Joe Biden being a really good fit for Barack Obama in 2008 and 2012 because his experience led him to having a large network of people that he knew that could potentially be donors and help raise money for campaigns. So it's an informal duty, but a critical duty for a vice presidential candidate. And then some sort of special task there. It always seems like we end up with the vice president serving on some kind of task force. Maybe most pertinent or most appropriate in a given moment is Mike Pence's role with the coronavirus task force that President Trump has created. If you've seen any of the coronavirus task force press conferences, typically at some point during those, you have Mike Pence kind of leading the charge and taking the questions because he's been given that responsibility. He's been given that position by the President of the United States. We all think it, and I'm sure vice presidents feel it, that they're just the person following the president around, just cleaning up his mess from time to time. But again, it is important to remember that that person is always just one heartbeat from the real deal. They're one heartbeat from the Oval Office at all times. The next group of people that has a significant role in helping the president run the country is the cabinet. The cabinet is the group of close advisors that works with the president, the heads of the different executive agencies. They tend to be a group of people that have a wide range of policy expertise. So you might have, you know, some people that have a very, very, very heavy background in international relations, in foreign relations. And then you'll have others that have almost zero foreign policy expertise, and they're almost exclusively domestic. But it's a close group of advisors, the head of those executive agencies that serve as the president's cabinet. So cabinet officers, oops, one too far there. These are the people that actually currently serve in the president's cabinet. So the Secretary of State, the Treasury, Defense, the Attorney General, Interior, Agriculture, Commerce, Labor, Health and Human Services, Housing and Urban Development, Transportation, Energy, Education, Veterans Affairs, and Homeland Security. So yeah, again, it's just about every piece of American life and the person responsible for running those different executive agencies that serves as the president's cabinet. And we've created and added to them, to those agencies over time, obviously, the most recent being the creation of the Department of Homeland Security in 2002 as a response to the September 11th attacks. Clientele agencies. Clientele agencies are another piece of the executive branch. They serve needs of specific groups of Americans. The best example that I have of clientele agencies is the VA. Right? The Department of Veterans Affairs is a perfect example of clientele agencies because they specifically are designed and tasked with serving the needs of veterans. The Department of Agriculture is another good one, but the VA really is so national in their impact, right? The Department of Agriculture has a little less impact in certain urban environments. The VA has an impact across the country. The President of the United States oftentimes does not rely on their cabinet for policy advice for a couple of really obvious reasons once you think about it. If you're serving in the President's cabinet, if you're the Secretary of State or you're the Secretary of Defense, a lot of times you have bigger career aspirations. You have bigger political aspirations because maybe you want to be the person sitting in the big chair someday. You'd like to be a potential candidate for president at some point. So a lot of times the president will not necessarily rely on the cabinet for policy advice because they're a little concerned that their cabinet members are sometimes a little selfish. Sometimes their cabinet members are looking for an opportunity to promote themselves and not necessarily do what's in the best interest of the administration. Cabinet members, all of these cabinet secretaries get their jobs by being appointed by the president of the United States. So much in the same way that the president appoints federal judges, he similarly appoints members of his cabinet. So if you remember when President Trump was elected in 2016, after his inauguration in early 2017, we started seeing all of these different confirmation hearings for all kinds of different people, right? Whether that was the Secretary of Defense, the Secretary of Education, particularly remember hers because I'm not a huge Betsy DeVos fan, but they're appointed and they have to be confirmed by the Senate. So when the president appoints somebody to that position, he gives that name, he gives that nomination to the Senate, it goes to the committee, and if it makes it out of committee, then it gets voted on by the entire Senate. The process looks almost exactly the same as it does for a federal judge. Oops, one too far again. The reason that Congress ultimately has a role to play in deciding who serves as these cabinet secretaries and these cabinet officers is because cabinet offices are created, funded, organized, and eliminated by Congress. Congress has complete authority over these cabinet offices. So yes, people like the Secretary of Education does in fact work for the executive branch, but they're really at the behest or at the beck and call of the legislative branch. So there is some oversight there when it comes to executive agencies within the legislative branch as well. So the West Wing is kind of the infamous home to the White House, to politics, and it's the politics shop or the policy shop in the White House. But what we kind of often kind of forget about is the OEOB, the old executive office building, just a short walk from the West Wing. But that's where a lot of these clientele agencies and different cabinet agents, some of these different cabinet agencies are housed. So if you're looking for, I don't know, the Secretary of Health and Human Services, you're not going to find that person in the West Wing. You're not going to find that person or any of their staffers or any of the people that work for the Department of Health and Human Services. You're not going to find them in the West Wing. So you might, but you might find them in the OEOB, the old Executive Office Building. So it's kind of a secondary piece to the White House, the White House's policy shop or their governing group, so to speak. In the OEOB, you're going to, or also inside the executive office or another group, set of groups that are encompassed in the executive branch are direct reports to the president. So things like the NSC probably being the most noticeable, the NSC, the National Security Council, they're going to serve as advisors to the president on any sort of security issues, potential attacks around the world, the presence of troops anywhere around the world, so on and so forth. Anything that has to do with national security, the NSC is going to take care of. And then the last one, or the other one that I would mention that is probably most commonly talked about is the OMB, the Office of Management and Budget. And a lot of times they're going to be the ones that say, yeah, Mr. President, I know that you're really wanting to change the way that we do school funding, but here's what that's actually going to cost, right? So a lot of times this is just like the basically the president's accountants is essentially what the OMB becomes. The next group, the White House staff. Yes, there's about a million other staffers that work inside the White House. Some of them provide the services necessary to run the residence. The residence is largely on the second floor of the White House some parts of the first floor, but largely on the second floor of the White House. And they serve in a variety of roles. Obviously, the White House staff has to include chefs, has to include gardeners, has to include all of the different different professions and job opportunities to make the White House run on a daily basis, to serve the people that live there and work there, so on and so forth. There's also going to be all kinds of different advisors, whether those be policy advisors, whether those be speech writers, so, which we'll get to here a little bit more in just a bit. But key aides and senior advisors are going to be a really significant piece of the president's kind of trusted group that when it comes time to make a decision, you know, these people are working in and around the White House. They have different expertise, different focuses, different specialties, and he brings them in as necessary to advise him as he sees fit. When the president is looking for people that are going to act as aides and advisors in the White House, typically, again, he's looking for people with a key expertise. So a lot of times what you'll end up with is you end up with one or two people in parts of the White House that their only expertise is in Latin America, right? They know everything there is to know about Latin American countries, about Latin American rulers, about Latin American economies, about Latin American culture, customs, so on and so forth. And if at any point the president realizes that we're in a situation involving a Latin American country, well, now he has one or two people that he can bring in to consult with and to discuss his options with those people. So these aides and advisors are all over the place in Washington, and the president leans on them very heavily. Again, policymaking, I already explained this. Any opportunity I get to plug the West Wing, I'm going to. I've been coronavirus rewatching the West Wing, and I'm currently into season 5, so I am crushing it on my West Wing rewatch. But a lot of one of the things that you heard frequently, if you've watched the show or if you ever do, is this phrase: "I serve at the pleasure of the president," and it really is, I think, the perfect quote to describe or to sum up the role of so many people that work in the White House. That, yeah, there's a million people doing a million different jobs, whether that be the NSC or key advisors on Latin America that I've mentioned earlier, or the Secretary of Education or the Secretary of Health and Human Services. But ultimately, it all comes down to that line, to this line right here, that one quote: "I serve at the pleasure of the president." You get that, you've got that job because of the person that's in the office. And if the person in that office changes, turns out you usually lose that job as well. President Trump obviously has his own team, and I'm sorry for the picture that's significantly outdated at this point, but it's the only one where everybody's labeled. Rens Priebus hasn't been the chief of staff for a while, and Sean Spicer has been on Dancing with the Stars since this picture was taken. But again, you can kind of see the way that the president identifies those people that he wants to work most closely with. The person leading the conversation and directing traffic for the White House so much of the time is the person that fills the role of chief of staff. The chief of staff is frequently referred to as the gatekeeper for the president, and a lot of times he's also referred to as the president's quarterback. The gatekeeper analogy essentially meaning that if you want to talk to the president, you got to run it by that guy first. You're not getting in the Oval Office to talk to the president of the United States unless you first cleared it with the chief of staff, right? That's the probably the best friend that any president has is his chief of staff. If you want to know exactly what a chief of staff does, this video does a really nice job of talking about that. But the chief of staff, because of their demands of their job, is a job with very, very high turnover. In his 8 years in office, President Obama had 5 different chiefs of staff. Dennis McDonough serving for the last 4 years, the entire second term, Dennis McDonough did that job. But everyone knew that if you wanted to get 5 minutes with the president, if you wanted to have 5 minutes to talk to President Obama about anything, you were going to have to run it by Dennis McDonough first. It just wasn't going to happen otherwise. And in that way, a lot of times, the chief of staff is the president's gatekeeper. At this point in his term, President Trump is on his 4th chief of staff. We started with Reince Priebus, made our way through John Kelly and Mick Mulvaney, and ultimately at this point have landed on Mark Meadows. So Mark Meadows hasn't been in this job for very long. He's only been in the job for about a month, but it's just a job with high turnover. You're at the president's beck and call at all times. If all of a sudden there's some sort of a terrorist attack in Turkey in the middle of the night, guess what? The president has to walk down from his bedroom. You have to drive in from wherever you live, right? You have to respond to it. You're going to be expected to respond to that situation, or to at least be made aware of that situation at any given moment. The president has to go down a flight of stairs to get to his office. It's just a huge time demand, and it's an extremely stressful position for the people that serve in it. So for that reason, we see a lot of turnover. Other really significant pieces of the president's staff are going to be his speechwriting team. Typically, there's somebody that serves as what we would call the director of communications in the White House, and that person is going to be the top speechwriter in the White House. And then that person's going to have several different deputies that work underneath them, and they're really responsible for crafting the president's message to the public, whether that be in speeches, campaign stops, press releases, whatever the case might be. Those speechwriters and that communication staff is going to be critical. Again, we mentioned senior advisors earlier. They're always bouncing around, able to advise and provide kind of a consult to the president if some sort of obscure policy issue comes up. And all of the people that I've mentioned to this point are reliant on the person in the Oval Office. The second that the president is either term limited and is leaving the White House, or the second that the person loses their reelection bid, but the second that Barack Obama was not going to be coming back as president, the second that President Trump was sworn in as the president of the United States, most of the people that work in the White House, most of that White House staff was out of a job. Okay, now maybe the butlers, maybe the cooks and the chefs didn't lose their jobs, but all of those communication staffs people, all of those senior advisors and aides, all of the people that have any kind of policy input whatsoever, all of them are looking for a job because they're appointed or they're specifically just hired by the president. They aren't elected and stay there. No, they're out the second the president's out. Again, the chief of staff, I mentioned him earlier, the best chief of staff ever. This is just another opportunity for me to plug the West Wing, Leo McGarry, chief of staff for life. But the current chief of staff, the reason I wanted to get to this is the current chief of staff, I mentioned him earlier, Mark Meadows. I'm sure that over the course of the next couple of months, Mark Meadows is going to feel firsthand the stress of that position. And then the last piece of the conversation when it comes to the White House and how it operates and how that building actually runs is that of the First Lady. And the reason that I wanted to address the First Lady last is because each First Lady kind of decides what is their role going to be in the administration. For some of them, they have a very active, very prominent, very engaged role in the administration. Right. I mean, you saw that with Michelle Obama with her work on school lunches. You're seeing that currently with President Trump's wife, Melania, and her work on cyberbullying is her big issue. I want to talk to about Ronald Reagan's wife, Nancy, pictured on the left there. She was extremely passionate and worked very hard to control the war on drugs. But again, what you should see over and over is that typically the first lady has picked one particular area or one particular policy issue, one particular policy item rather, and kind of made that their mission, right? They're going to identify some cause and they're going to have some sort of, big time impact on that particular issue, in their role as first lady. So it's a little bit of a unique role because it's nebulous and it changes and they're able to kind of do with it as they'd like. And everybody kind of handles that role differently. I apologize for this one being long. I knew it was going to be, but I wanted to get as much of this in as I could yet this week. Have a great weekend, and I will see you guys back here next week.